In this final section of Module 2, we will now discuss the concept of effect sizes.
Effect sizes play an important role in all aspects of the WWC's reporting of study findings. The WWC uses effect sizes to determine the direction of a finding, to assess whether the finding was favorable or unfavorable. And the WWC uses effect sizes to determine the magnitude or size of a finding. During the course of a study review, the WWC may calculate an effect size at two different points. First, when applicable, the WWC may calculate effect sizes to assess the magnitude of baseline differences between the intervention and comparison groups. Second, the WWC will calculate effect sizes when estimating and reporting on the effects of the intervention, which then impacts the study or intervention's effectiveness rating. In the rest of this module, we will provide a high-level overview of how the WWC calculates effect sizes, but Module 11 in this training series provides more in-depth equations for people interested in those technical details. Finally, it is important to note that the WWC's online study review guide includes tools to assist with all effect size calculations conducted as part of a WWC study review. The WWC calculates effect sizes in different ways based on the types of variables the study used to measure outcomes. For continuous measures, or variables that have many possible values, such as standardized achievement test scores, the WWC calculates a standardized mean difference effect size. The standardized mean difference effect size, or Hedges G, represents the impact of the intervention and standard deviation units. This Hedges G effect size can be conceptualized as roughly equivalent to the Cohen's D effect size, which is likely familiar to many researchers, which again represents the average difference between an intervention and comparison condition in a standardized way. Because the effect size provides a common standardized scale for measuring impacts, it can be used to compare findings across different outcome measures. For the same reason, the effect size allows the WWC to aggregate impacts across outcomes and studies in order to summarize evidence. This slide shows a general equation the WWC uses to calculate a Hedges G effect size. Hedges G represents the difference between the average of a characteristic for intervention group members and the average of a characteristic for comparison group members divided by the pooled standard deviation of that characteristic, where the pooled standard deviation is just the weighted average of each group's standard deviation. Where Hedges G deviates slightly from the popular Cohen's D effect size is that Hedges G also includes an adjustment factor for smaller sample sizes. So let us walk through this equation together. First, we see that the greater of the effect size calculation includes B, which represents the unstandardized mean difference between the intervention and comparison groups on some measure. And this mean difference is multiplied by an omega term, which is simply the small sample size correction. This omega term is what differentiates the Hedges G effect size from the popular Cohen D's effect size you often see in literature. The denominator of the effect size calculation then represents the pooled standard deviation, and this is what standardizes the effect size to ensure it is in standard deviation units. So, in the denominator, we see Ni and Nc are the sample sizes for the intervention and comparison groups, respectively. The I and C indicate the intervention group and comparison groups, respectively. And Sdi and Sdc are the unadjusted standard deviations for the intervention and the comparison groups, respectively. So, we see that the denominator in this equation with a pooled standard deviation represents the weighted average of both groups' standard deviations. This equation, along with all the important equations used by the WWC, is discussed in greater detail in Index E of the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook.
Let's walk through an example of how to calculate a Hedges G effect size for a continuous variable. In this example, we have sample sizes and standard deviations on a continuous measure, as well as an unstandardized mean difference for the intervention and comparison groups.
The difference in means between the intervention and comparison groups is 4.0, And let's imagine this was reported in the form of an unstandardized coefficient from a linear regression model that included a dummy variable indicating intervention group status. The standard deviation is 10 in both groups, and the sample size for the intervention group is 120, and the sample size for the comparison group is 100. Plugging these numbers into the Hedges G equation, we find that Hedges G is equal to 0.4 standard deviations. This means that the intervention group average is 0.4 standard deviations larger than that of the comparison group. The WWC may also translate these Hedges G effect sizes into an improvement index. Some WWC products report the improvement index in addition to an effect size. For example, the improvement index is reported in intervention reports, but not in practice guides. The improvement index is a transformation of the Hedges G effect size that represents the expected change in percentile rank for an average comparison group student if the student had received the intervention. Put another way, it measures the effect of the intervention in percentile points if the comparison group's average performance was at the 50th percentile. In our example calculation, we calculated a Hedges G effect size of 0.4 standard deviations. This effect size translates to an improvement index of 16 percentile points. Namely, with an effect size of this magnitude, the average comparison group, or a student of the 50th percentile, would be expected to score at the 66th percentile if they had received the intervention. The difference between 66 and 50 is 16, so the improvement index is 16 percentile points. See Appendix E of the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook for more guidance on how the WWC calculates the improvement index. For dichotomous variables, which are variables that have only two possible categories, the WWC uses a version of the Cox index to calculate an effect size. Dichotomous variables include variables such as graduating or not, passing or failing a test, enrolling or not enrolling in a course, or any other variable that has two possible categories. Cox's index is designed to produce an effect size measure that is comparable to Hedges G. Here is the formula for Cox's index. The formula includes the natural logarithm function, written as ln, and also includes an intermediary calculation called an odds ratio, written as OR. Without going into too much technical detail about the mathematical concepts, Cox's index applies the natural logarithm to the odds ratio, indexing the ratio of the odds of an event in the intervention and comparison groups. You can find more information about this formula in Appendix E of the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook. Let's walk through an example of how to calculate Cox's index. In this example, let's say 100 students are in the intervention group and 50 students are in the comparison group. Let's say our dichotomous variable of interest is whether or not students reached grade level proficiency on a mathematics test. In this example, 45% of the intervention group students were proficient, whereas 55% of the intervention group students were not proficient. And 47% of the comparison group students were proficient, whereas 53% were not. We can transform these percentages into probabilities by dividing them by 100.
For this outcome, the Cox's index effect size value is -0.0488, which indicates that the intervention group average is 0.0488 standard deviations smaller than that of the comparison group. The equations we just covered for Hedges G and Cox's index are general effect size formulas.
However, the WWC uses different variations on these general formulas that account for differences in how study authors reported their findings. When calculating Hedges G effect sizes for continuous measures, these equations will vary depending on the type of information reported by study authors, as well as whether the study used individual or cluster-level assignments to conditions. When calculating Cox's index effect sizes for dichotomous measures, these equations can also vary depending on the type of statistical information reported by the study authors. Module 11 in this training series provides additional technical details for people interested in these variations in effect size calculations. Now, study authors may report their own effect size estimate. The WWC generally prefers WWC computed effect sizes because we can verify the computational accuracy of those effect sizes. However, for impact estimates, the WWC also generally prefers effect sizes that have been adjusted for baseline differences, even if the WWC does not require that baseline adjustment. Therefore, the WWC generally prefers WWC computed effect sizes and effect sizes that have been adjusted for baseline differences. There are, nevertheless, two common scenarios in which the WWC may elect to use the study reported effect size. First, this may occur when the WWC cannot compute an effect size based on the reported information. Or second, when the WWC can compute an effect size based on unadjusted means, but the study reported effect size adjusts for baseline differences. However, the WWC will not use study reported effect sizes in the following scenarios. First, when the study reported effect size was based on unadjusted means, but the study requires adjustment for baseline differences. Second, when the study reported effect size did not use unadjusted individual level standard deviations in the denominator of the effect size calculation. And third, when the study authors report insufficient information on the computation approach, such that the WWC review team cannot be confident that the researchers' calculations aligned with the WWC's effect size calculations. In addition to reporting effect sizes that represent the magnitude of findings, the WWC will also assess the statistical significance of those findings. An effect is described as statistically significant when the measured differences between groups is unlikely to have been observed under the assumption that the intervention had no impact. The WWC follows a standard convention that labels a finding as statistically significant when the probability of observing an effect that is at least as large as the measured effect, under the assumption that the intervention has no impact, is less than 1 in 20 or 5%. To compute the statistical significance of an effect, the WWC will first compute the standard error for the effect size. The standard error represents the uncertainty in the effect size estimate, where larger standard errors correspond to less precise estimates of the true intervention effect. Statistically significant findings, then, are those where the WWC observes a large effect size relative to its standard error. In addition to reporting on their own effect sizes, study authors can report on the determination of its statistical significance. The WWC generally prefers study-reported statistical significance unless the study authors fail to adjust for baseline differences or clustering in the data when those adjustments are required. For some studies, the WWC may also need to combine multiple findings into a composite finding at the outcome domain level, and then determine the effect size and statistical significance of that WWC-constructed composite. Although the WWC generally prefers study-reported p-values and statistical significance for study findings, there are four common scenarios where a reviewer should favor the WWC-computed statistical significance. First, when the study authors did not include statistical significance estimates. Second, when study authors' calculations have a known problem, such as not applying a required adjustment for baseline differences. Third, when study authors did not account for clustering in an individual level analysis for a cluster level assignment study. And fourth, when study authors reported statistical significance based on unadjusted analysis, but the WWC requires analysis to be adjusted for baseline differences. It is also worth noting that if the multiple main findings meet WWC standards in the same outcome domain, the WWC will also pool these findings to determine the effect size and statistical significance at the domain level. The composite, as opposed to individual findings, would then be used to determine the study's effectiveness rating in the outcome domain. The procedures for these calculations are described in greater detail in Appendix F of the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook. This concludes the second module in the WWC Group Design Standards training. Let's review what we discussed in this module. We described each of the steps in the WWC study review process. We then explained how the WWC determines research ratings for study findings, and how the WWC then determines a study level research rating. We also described how the WWC determines effectiveness ratings. And finally, we provided a high-level overview of how the WWC calculates effect sizes during the study review process. Remember that you can access all of the resources mentioned in this module on the WWC website, whatworks.ed.gov.